Clerkship, Chief Justice, Honorable Jayanta Jayasurya, President Council, Honorable Minister of Justice, Mr. Ali Sapre, President's Council, Acting Solicitor General, Mr. Sanjay Rajaratnam, President's Council. Secretary of the Ministry of Justice, Senior Additional Solicitor General, Mr. Sarat Jayamana, President's Council, Mr. Sumati Dharmavadana, President's Council, Senior Members of the Attorney General's Department, and all those present here this morning. Good morning. May I first thank His Lordship, Chief Justice, and the Honorable Minister, Mr. Ali Sapre, for accepting an invitation at very short notice to grace this occasion today. Your presence means a lot to us, and I think it's quite fitting and appropriate that both of you are here with us this morning when we celebrate a historic event, historic, momentous occasion, a milestone in the long history of this hallowed institution of the Attorney General, which is old as a century and more than a quarter. Now, may I term this a soft opening by all means, and the grand opening of this building is scheduled for January 2021, and the Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksa, has graciously agreed to be the chief guest on that occasion. I think it's most fitting that he be here with us on that occasion, as he was the architect of this massive project. Now, this is a smart building. It's equipped with all the modern facilities and will be in due course. There are 12 stories, basement car park, and a conference room facility with multimedia for every floor. The chambers of council are well equipped with modern furniture and facilities. And this auditorium, when properly furnished, will house at least 275 persons. Now, this building is very environmentally friendly. There are open spaces at rooftop level, and the second floor, where officers will be encouraged to take a break, relax, and de-stress during their busy work schedules. So, I think we are all fortunate and should be thankful to successive governments and presidents for supporting this massive endeavor, which has become a reality today. Now, space has always been a problem. At the moment, our strength runs up to 235 officers, 238 to be precise, of a 500 cadre, officer cadre. And we have 578 non-legal staff. We have several units, the CH unit, the INE unit, the narcotics unit, the cooperation division, and the building which we are occupying currently has three floors with the ground floor, and in addition we have rented out a building at the Technical College Junction which houses part of our department. We pay a monthly rental of 2.8 million rupees for 15,800 square feet. That's the Medihouse building. And as mentioned by Mr. Dharmavardhana, we are stretched to our limits. These facilities are housing nearly 900 persons on a daily basis. 900. And the most affected are the state council and the non-legal staff who have been working in very poor conditions. And I don't think I'll be wrong if I term it as appalling conditions. The staff, non-legal staff, are actually sandwiched at the moment. They have no room and space to move. There are files on top of their tables, under their tables, and around the office. Our record room is saturated. So as a result, we don't have space to store our concluded files. These files are stored in the offices where the staff, non-legal staff, work. And there is dust and dirt, rats and cockroaches and other insects who have made these piles of files a cozy habitat. So the conditions of service of the non-legal staff and the legal staff are poor by no means. But we have not complained. We have not complained. We have never complained. We have worked to the best, performed to the best, and delivered to the best. But in trying and testing conditions. So I think it's very fitting, timely and appropriate that we have come to open this facility to alleviate the working conditions of our legal and non-legal staff. We don't have consultation rooms. The state council cannot accommodate more than 2 officers, public servants, in their chambers. If there is one consultation going on in a shared room, it's impossible for the other officer to have a consultation at the same time. So we have had to adjust, and it has affected the dignity of our office tremendously over the years. But we have carried on regardless, and this is a long awaited moment in time, which I think will no doubt alleviate the poor state of affairs which prevail in terms of our working conditions. I think a government, a good government, ought to provide public servants a comfortable and pleasant working environment. If not, one cannot expect to have that level of performance. So if one requires to optimize performance, enhance the performance, improve the performance, and get a quality product, a quantitative product, it is no doubt the working conditions which underlie and which enable that situation. So I think that space and infrastructure and space and facilities are critical to the performance of our day-to-day work and service. So I think this is a good fulfillment of that expectation. And once again, I thank the government for enabling this occasion. Now, to tell you that we cannot be content, because this space is not enough. We have been constrained in our recruitment due to space. Now, in terms of the cadre, we have filled only part of the cadre. We have provisioned to recruit 218 state council. 218. And we have 136 at the moment. We have provisioned to recruit 136 assistant state council. And we have only 6. We have a cadre of 58 senior state council. And at the moment, the cadre filled is 36. Then in other cadres, the state attorney's division, we have not filled the full cadre. And we are not actually staffed to our full potential. So this building will actually not satisfy our total needs. You might be surprised, but it's a fact. So there is a yearning need for space. But how I see it is that one cannot be craving for space and asking for space and taxing governments all the time. The only solution, as I see it, is a virtual office where we switch to a e-solution. So I think e-governance has to prevail. And most of our activities in terms of our engagement could be met if we go e-governance. So the conferences, in this age of COVID, I think has compelled us to move towards e-system, and I think it's time that we did so. And adjust our structures accordingly. So the solution which I think we need to work to is an e-solution in terms of office management and our daily engagement in terms of our engagement with other government institutions, in terms of voicemail, email, then the electronic case management. The e-communication, the research aspects. We are actually, to tell you, provided this building has a facility which we need to develop for a virtual library, an e-library. So there will be two e-libraries. And we have already received the funding for the e-library. So I think this whole facility should be used to develop a virtual office environment and equip this building in order to maximize on the space. Now, the effects of this I did not really tell you. It's cost safe, it's secure, it provides the environment which is convenient to communicate. And it's fast. So from every aspect, I think it is, I think, the way forward to enhance the capacity of this building for us to travel on a e-path and bring in a regime of electronic communication in every aspect. Now, I must tell you and thank you that we have worked untirelessly, unselfishly, at all risk during the COVID pandemic. We have braved the pandemic. All of you have worked and we have delivered. And I think we have shown the country what we can do. We have supported the health authorities during the pandemic with whatever legal support which was required, right through to uphold the rule of law in this country. During the pandemic, we have statistics will bear witness to our efforts. Statistics. Now, officers have actually put their heart and soul during this period. I think we can be proud that we have delivered despite all odds. Despite all odds. And we have managed to overcome the risk by following strict health guidelines, health guidelines, adhering to procedures, and supported the judiciary and law enforcement and the other public institutions. Now you will be surprised that our cooperation division services 280 public corporations. 280, the cooperation division. So 280 public corporations were serviced during this period, apart from all the public institutions in this country. And over the last 2 years, ending December, we have disposed of 26,444 criminal cases. 26,000. We have forwarded 13,835 indictments to the High Court. 13,385. We have discharged over 6,500 accused suspects. We have provided advice to the police in over 5,000 cases. So this is an unprecedented achievement. This year, we have concluded over 11,000 cases despite this country being plagued with the COVID pandemic throughout the year. Now 13,385 indictments have been forwarded to the high courts of this country. High courts. And it's a challenge for the judiciary to work through these cases. And I must, on this occasion, assure the Chief Justice that you will have a wholehearted support in disposing this huge backlog. 13,500 nearly added to the grid. So 26,444 cases is a massive effort in the history of our 136-year history of our department. We are probably the only institution which provides and has that engagement with the executive, with the judiciary, and with the legislature. And we do all this with 238 officers. We have 42 high courts to service. 42 high courts. The Court of Appeal, the Supreme Court, the Commercial High Court, the district courts throughout the country, the Magistrates Court, the Labour Tribunals. Disciplinary inquiries against judges, magistrates. We sit on committees. We advise the government all the time, every time. Ministries, government departments, boards, statutory bodies, public corporations. All that is done by 238 officers, my dear friends. So this is unimaginable. We have around 115 officers in the criminal division. And these 115 have disposed of 26,444 files. The Child Protection Unit had a massive backlog. We have disposed 14,500 child abuse cases over the last 2 years. 14,500. We have now less than 500. Less than 500. So we have proved our competence. Within the last 2 years, we have cleared our house, cleared our backlog, and we are on track, on course. And now we have to maintain the tempo, keep up the tempo, and proceed. There is no relaxing. There is no relaxing. We can't afford to relax. And I think I owe a massive thank you to my officers for supporting me in this huge effort and endeavor. And it's, I think, a blessing that we were able to do this. We had the courage, the perseverance, the ability, and the urge, the motivation to clear this backlog for the people of this country. So we have by no means upheld the rule of law. And I don't think it would be fair to say that now that we are responsible for the law's delays in this country. We have come out proud, and we are proud of it. We can stand tall and say, we go by statistics. I have all the statistics here. But we need to maintain our commitment, our motivation, and the relentless pursuit to achieve the ideals which we are called upon to fulfill. So, my dear colleagues, on this occasion, I think we are on top. Now, I spoke of our contribution during the pandemic. It's still ongoing. We have supported all the sectors in government throughout the pandemic. We have braved the Saturdays, the Sundays. Files have come to my house. I have signed letters on my dining table during this period. Officers have risked their lives, but we have still been able to be untouched. So that blessing is there. And I must tell you that I have advised the police on an umpteen number of occasions during this pandemic. Twice to reduce the overcrowding in prisons. I gave advice in April, strict, precise guidelines, and for reasons which are unknown to me, those guidelines, those instructions were not implemented by the IGP. Then again, I was asked, on that occasion, the Honorable Minister made a request from me to advise the police to reduce the overcrowding in prisons. And that advice went in late November. And that has been implemented. But unfortunately, this situation may not have been as grave if my advice was carried out in April. I gave comprehensive advice on drug cases as well as other crime on two fronts, which was not carried out in April. But I thank the minister for intervening in November, and on that occasion the police have now started and they are implementing our advice to reduce the overcrowding in prisons. So we have done our job. And we are not responsible for the overcrowding in prisons. We are not responsible. To the contrary, I have taken all steps and measures to reduce the overcrowding. And the drug narcotics unit, we have worked on Saturdays and Sundays this year. File disposal workshops to reduce the backlog. And the narcotics unit has less than 200 cases now. I might be right if I say less than 100. So there are 12,000 remandees who are in remand for drug crime today. 12,000. 12,000 drug remandees. And as the prison authorities say, the majority of the prison population is addicted to narcotics. So out of that 12,000 cases, we have less than probably 100 or 150. So we are not responsible for the prison situation today as an institution. We are not responsible. The responsibility lies elsewhere. So, my dear colleagues, we are here to play a pivotal role in the administration of justice in this country and to uphold the rule of law at all costs. And I think you have understood that and you have played that role. Public institutions, institutions of government, live on public confidence. So public confidence is critical for government institutions, for state institutions, for public institutions. The sovereignty of the people are being exercised by these institutions. So we are answerable to the people. We are accountable to the people. And that transparency, accountability, and responsiveness should be seen in public institutions. Responsiveness. We have to respond to the public call, the need, the cry. Why do I respond to matters of public importance. Why? I respond to matters of public importance because it is important to the public that we act fast and properly. So, it's critical. And the rule of law cannot be upheld unless these public institutions enjoy the public confidence and the public acceptance. So I have, over this period, engaged the people of this country. And I'm very thankful to the media for playing that role, a pivotal role, in the dissemination of information to the public. In the dissemination of information, the correct information in the proper perspective and sense. Because the people of this country have a right to know. We live on the public purse. And we are accountable to the public. So that accountability is fulfilled only if the public are informed when necessary. So I have always strived to fulfill that aspect while performing our functions and duties. We have to build up that public confidence in what we do. The public approval is important because it is the people of this country who are sovereign. And we are required to discharge our functions for the people. For the people. So we are accountable to the people. We have to be responsive to the people. So this, I think, has happened where we have had that engagement and disseminated information, sufficient information, enough information, and not more information than necessary. Enough information for the public to know, which would enable the public to appreciate and understand the work which is being done for the public. So that has been another critical engagement which I think public institutions should follow. So for that to happen, you have to work. If you don't work, then you have to hide. You have to hide from the public. When you are working, you have to make sure. Because these institutions thrive and live on that public acceptance, on public confidence. So that is something, I think, which we have been mindful of. And I think we have engaged the public satisfactorily and sufficiently. And there has been actually no demand on this institution for information, for more than what we have given. There has been no demand. That satisfaction has always been there, that what has been given, what has been disseminated, has been enough, always enough. So that is something to be happy and satisfied of. Now, I said this in Vaunia when I declared open the bungalow for our state council of the Northern Province, that you have to ensure that public property is protected by all means. Public resources, property, you are duty bound to protect and maintain public property. So these buildings, the equipment, the furniture, the facilities should be maintained always. Protected and maintained and not allowed to depreciate. What happens today in government institutions is there is no maintenance of facilities. There is no maintenance. That actually causes a huge burden on the government in terms of finding resources to maintain public facilities. Because we don't maintain. If we maintain, which is at very minimal cost, we will not have to spend. Now we spend because we don't maintain. So please protect what you have got. Look after it like your own home. Live in it. Be comfortable and happy, and let it enhance your performance. Please, don't misuse public property and don't abuse it. So that is something as senior officers you have to pass on to your juniors and the staff. Because today this building is looking majestic, nice and beautiful. But in 5 years, it should have the same appearance. It should have the same appearance. Please ensure it. Ensure that it happens. And don't waste resources and public property. So I hope that this building, I hope and pray that this building of the Attorney General's Department will be a living monument to the cause of justice of the Attorney General and its officers today and forever. So that is all up to you, now and the future. I cannot conclude without thanking those people who were involved and who played a pivotal role, an important role, a salutary role in the construction of this majestic building. Now, from the department end, I have to thank the former Attorney General and present Chief Justice for driving this project for 3 years, since 2016 to 2019, May. He played a leading role, and I was always by his side supporting him. I know how he went into every nitty-gritty detail, and I must thank him for letting me do some of the selections here. He had that confidence in me, and I don't think I have disappointed anybody here. So some of the facilities here, the material especially, he let me select. Though he could have easily done it, he let me do it. And he was behind me and all of us. Sumati was also a driving force. He was all there, always there for the former Attorney General. We worked together, and he led, the Chief Justice led from the front, and he left it to us, and he monitored where it mattered. But he had a hallmark of Mr. Jayasurya is that he had the trust and confidence in his senior officers. So those who work closely with him will know it. He gave them a free hand, and I think I'm one person who had the benefit of that outlook of his, where he gave me a free hand to run the criminal division. And also in the affairs of this building, we worked as a team. And so I must thank once again the Honorable Chief Justice for showing the way and the method. Mr. Dharmavardhana, who has been a live wire, a leader in this whole endeavor. Mr. Ishan Ratnapala and the construction team. We had a team, a core team. So that team supported this endeavor. Then I cannot forget Mr. Rohan Tudav, who is seated out there. So I think it was very easy working with Rohan. He was always very accommodating and very generous in his outlook. He made very few demands for money, and he was really committed. He was present always in the building, on the rooftop, braving age. He did not hesitate to climb up there. There were no lifts. But I saw him more often than not on the top of the building, supervising and driving the workforce. So Rohan, thank you for your commitment. And the construction, I think, is solid, impressive. And we are very thankful, and I hope that you in the future will support the government with similar engagements, not really profit oriented, but to serve the people of this country. Then one individual I cannot forget is Vatsala Amarakuvan, who is also seated out there. She was also there all the time. She was behind, she was the architect of this project from the CCB. And she, I think, performed a marvelous role here with all the design and construction, the expertise to make this a majestic building. She was always accommodating. I think we were very demanding, and all those demands were met. They are irrespective of the time. She met all the demands, the last minute demands. And I think her expertise and her team also made this whole affair an absolute reality. So I don't think I have really left out anybody. So I think that brings me to the end of what I really intended to say. Now it remains for you to use these facilities and prove yourself and prove that this institution is in the forefront of public affairs and provides a pivotal role, as it has done before, but in a larger sense, to the administration of justice of this, in this country, and to uphold the rule of law. So I think by the day I leave, I would have fulfilled my task as I had planned to the best of my ability. So this is something for the last 1.5 years or more I had in mind to fulfill. Then the Vavuniya Bungalow and the Manna Bungalow, and a regional office for the Northern Province, which is also about to start, a regional office. So that construction will start in January, and the Sri Lanka Army have promised to complete that project by latest April. So hopefully I will be in a position to open that office, regional office. And I have told Sumati and others to Sumati Dharmawal to look for land in the central province and the southern province to set up two other regional offices, so that our effective presence and engagement could be seen and felt in all parts of the country, and not forgetting the East. So this is something for the future. So I think we have to seriously think of cutting office space.